your top performers are driven by a very clear vision about what they want to do after high school. And that makes the work very easy. Coach Chin here with the Junior Lions Lake Nona Youth Sports. We're the feeder program for Lake Nona High School. And I've got with me Alex Torres and Justin Ucros. These are some of our more dedicated players at the high school level. Justin is playing at college now, 50% scholarship, and Alex is on his way to play for college. So he's a senior graduating this year. We're doing this video so that you can have a tutorial on some of the fundamentals if you're brand new to the sport or you've plateaued as far as your personal skills go and you want to take your game to the next level, because we're going to cover passing, catching, scooping, cradling, and just some fundamental stuff for developing players in the sport. And anytime you see an exclamation point like this on the screen, it's a point or a detail, a distinction with the movement or the technique that you want to be sure that you're getting right. And I promise you that if whatever you're doing in the game as far as your personal skills goes isn't on point, or your passes are going down, or whatever that is, or you're missing a ground ball, or you're shoveling the ground, it's because you're not following one of those exclamation points, one of those detailed distinctions. So watch this video. It's perfect for any of you getting ready for the season, or if you're newer to the sport, or like I said, you've plateaued. And one big takeaway here, whether it's lacrosse or any other skill you're developing, is there's a saying that if you want what 98% of the population has, or other players have, or other athletes have, in any context of your life, then do what other 98% do. If you want the 2% of what the outliers or the top performers do, then you'll do the little extra on a consistent basis to set yourself apart. And one thing I like that I notice in between players who are always developing their skills and standing apart and growing leaps and bounds every single year compared to players who aren't growing that much or aren't as big contributors on the team, is that your top performers are driven by a very clear vision about what they want to do after high school. And that makes the work very easy. So if you hadn't been bit by the lacrosse bug or any kind of bug, then just remember that in your life about anything that you pursue. Be a 2%er, work on the details. When you're coming to lacrosse practice with your team, keep in mind that coming to lacrosse practice with your team is to work on team concepts. Clearing, transitional play, settled offense, defense, those concepts with your other teammates. Do not come to practice working on throwing and catching and picking up ground balls and cradling. So your personal skills, take responsibility to work on that outside of practice. And then when you're coming to practice, you can contribute, you can help the team, and then all of you are working together to get better as a team on team concept. So without further delay, we're gonna get into some personal skills, and we're gonna start off with just some fundamentals on throwing, catching, cradling, ball control, and then picking up ground balls. If you get those basics down and you're working on that on a consistent basis, you will show up to practice and be a contributor, and your other teammates are gonna know it. And if you're not, on the other side of that coin, your teammates are gonna know that too. And it's not gonna be a fun experience for you. So anyway, we'll get into it right now. Okay guys, we're gonna start off with just some basic throwing and catching, all right? Like any sport, a lot of technique starts with your feet and then kind of comes up from there. So when we're throwing and catching, you'll notice that on the far side here, Alex is bladed, meaning that he's in athletic stance. We call it the triple threat position, right? So whenever you're throwing and catching a lacrosse ball, don't stand square to where you're throwing and catching. You want to be bladed. It's almost like if I were to tell you to, we're going to do a foot race, and we're starting off on the line. We're gonna line up kind of like this with one foot in front of the other and our weights on the balls of our feet. We're getting ready to take off. They call it a triple threat position, same in basketball and other sports, because if you're throwing and catching like this, as soon as I catch the ball, I'm ready to either take off running on a dodge. I can throw from this position or pass, and then I can also shoot from this position, hence the triple threat. So you always want to be in athletic stance, never square and flat-footed to your target. That also goes if you're going to be wall-balling and throwing against a wall to get some reps in, always be athletic, okay? And then also you'll notice everybody has their helmets and their gloves on. If you're practicing, try to simulate gameplay as much as possible by wearing your gear if you can, okay? So, back to throwing and catching our stance. We're in a triple athletic stance. We are throwing the ball. We call it the three P's when we throw. It's pointing the stick, almost like a rifle, where we want it to go at our target. And then we push with the top hand and we pull with the bottom hand. It's almost as if in between my hands right here, there was a pin, and I'm just using that as kind of like a lever. That's a pivot point right in the middle of my hands, okay? I'm pushing with this one, I'm pulling with the bottom hand. Now, a couple things to keep in mind when you're throwing a lacrosse ball. This is the stick, here's your head, here's the shaft, here's kind of the neck of the stick, right? So when you're holding the stick on throwing and catching, you want to be light on your hands. So you're not, in other words, gripping the stick with your palms, you're almost holding it with your fingers. So as you kind of see my fingers here, I'm gripping the stick with my fingers. And you'll notice that as they're throwing and catching, you're not holding the stick stiff with the palms of your hand. You want loose hands, okay? So I'm gripping it with my hands, and when I'm throwing it, my top hand is in the middle of the stick for leverage. And then when I'm catching, I'm putting the head of my stick in what they call the box area. That's the target for the person throwing to you. And I'm keeping my hand up towards the neck of the stick and keeping the stick out in front of me. That way I can kind of catch it like an egg, because you want soft hands, you want that ball to kind of come into the stick. Here's one point that I see a lot of new players do is when they're catching a lacrosse ball, sometimes you have a tendency to turn the stick horizontal. As a new player, whenever the stick's turning horizontal, whether you're running with the stick or you're getting ready to shoot or you're dodging or you're trying to catch the ball, that's typically not healthy because the balls, you're not gonna have good ball control. And as you'll notice, as I turn the stick this way to kind of catch it like a basket, because new players sometimes have the assumption that if I hold the stick like a basket, gravity will keep in the pocket. Well, in doing that, you're cutting off the surface area where that ball can go. If I keep the stick vertical, the face of that head is open and ready to receive a catch, right? So again, we're bladed at the triple athletic stance, sticks in the box area. We keep it out in front of us so that we can, number one, if the ball goes over here, we can adapt very quickly. We can come down here, we can come across, sticks out in front, and then we're catching it like an egg. That's the easy way to remember that. So soften that catch, and then when we throw it, we're bringing it back here. The three P's, we're pointing, we're gonna push with our top hand and pull with our bottom, and we have a nice follow through, right? So catch it up here like this, then we throw it, bring our hand down, and that's how the motion should look. So we're gonna watch Justin and Alex here for a little bit. So you notice when Justin catches the ball, he's the one closest to us. His stick is out in front. He's giving Alex a target. And you wanna hit the person you're passing to in their box area so that they don't have to react and do unnecessary movements if they're, for example, on a cut to the goal. So we're bladed, athletic position. You want to keep your elbows up and out a little bit. I see a lot of new players. We have a tendency as new players sometimes to keep our elbows in and we're throwing like this. You want to keep it up, keep the stick generally high, and then throw. But what you don't want to get in the habit of doing as a new player is dropping the head of your stick below your hands. And I see that with new players when they're shooting the ball and they're cutting to the goal, or they're playing catch. And what happens is, especially when you're playing at game speed and game tempo, you have a tendency to drop the head of the stick lower than your hands. If you do that, that ball will come out or it'll roll to the top of your pocket, and then when you throw or shoot, it's gonna go high. So when you're throwing, you're prepping to throw, keep your hands up, but keep the head of the stick higher than your hands, okay? And then back here. Your stick really, if you're throwing a lacrosse ball, is almost like an extension of your body, and the mechanics are very similar to throwing a baseball or a football. So you're bladed again, the throw comes from up behind your ear or your head, and then you're following through forward. It's the same thing. All right, catching. Again, we're keeping our hands high on the top of the stick, close to the neck. That way, the closer your hand is to where that ball is going, the less you have to determine depth of how far that ball is gonna go to the pocket, right? So if I'm closer to the neck of the stick when I'm catching, number one, the stick is closer to my body. I have more control over the stick because I'm kind of choking up on it. And it's easier to find that ball as it's coming to me the closer my hand is to the pocket because it's closer to catching the ball with my hand, right? If you're on the bottom of your stick, and this goes for deep holes as well, defensemen, if you're far down on the stick and you're trying to catch and compensate for this two to three feet, then it makes it a lot harder to find that pocket, get that ball in the pocket. Okay guys, so now we're gonna work on ball control and cradling specifically, right? Basically keeping that ball in your pocket, because I don't care how athletic you are, we have some incredible athletes, multi-sport athletes that play lacrosse, and when they're entering the sport, one of the frustrating things is, just like if you were gonna start playing basketball, is you can't really take advantage of your athleticism and run hard and cut hard and really express yourself athletically unless you can keep that ball in your pocket. In basketball, it's the same as dribbling. If you can't dribble, it doesn't matter how fast you can run, you're not really going to be able to contribute on the court, right? So in lacrosse, that is cradling. That's protecting the ball, keeping the ball in your stick, being able to run full speed and cut and keep that ball in your pocket, right? When you're also in between throwing and catching. So when we're cradling, one thing you'll notice is whenever you see the stick moving around, a lot of parents ask me, why is their stick always moving and twiddling around? It's because we're trying to keep that ball seated in the pocket of our, in the middle of the pocket of our stick. So when we're throwing the ball, it's already seated, it's ready to go. It's where it needs to be, right? When you're running with the ball, this is a power cradle when you're using two hands. That ball stays right there in the back of the pocket. You can get checked. You can get physical with it and the ball's not gonna come out if you're cradling it. It's like having a bucket of water and you're using a centrifugal force, keeping the water at the bottom of the bucket, and you can spin the bucket all the way around and the water doesn't come out because the centrifugal force keeps that water at the bottom of the bucket. With a lacrosse stick, keeps the ball at the bottom of your pocket, right? So a power cradle is when you're running with two hands on the stick, and then if you're dodging or you're moving around with the ball and you have one hand on the stick, then that's a single hand cradle, right? So we're gonna demonstrate how you do that, right? So when you're cradling a stick with two hands, the bottom hand is kind of like when you're playing pool, the front hand is a guide for the cue. In lacrosse, this bottom hand is really not doing anything except just guiding the bottom of the stick. You're keeping it in the same spot. You wanna keep that stick vertical. You don't wanna drop it ideally until you get a little bit more advanced, right? You wanna keep it vertical and you keep it tight against your body. So if you're defending me, I'm protecting my stick this way, protecting it this way, and keeping my body in between my defender and the stick, right? Because I'm protecting my stick and I'm valuing this ball. So when you're cradling, that bottom hand, all it is a guide. Your top hand is where the work is happening, right? So now if you can see my hand here, the ball, all you're doing with the cradle is you're not twisting the stick. A lot of new players just want to twist the stick like this. That's not what you're doing. If you're feeling the ball just rattling around and hitting the sidewalls of the head, that means you're doing it wrong, okay? A cradle is really you're pushing the ball along on what it's naturally doing. So if you were to just balance the stick with the ball in it, just like this in your hand, and you rock it back and forth, notice my hand's not doing anything. I'm just going forward and backward. The stick naturally wants to cradle, right? And when you start to cradle and accelerate that, all you're doing is curling your fingers and then letting them out. So you're curling them in, letting them out, curling them in, letting them out. That's all you're doing. And you're almost creating, like, imagine if there was a glowing bulb at the end of this stick, the head here, you're creating the letter C. So you notice I'm making the letter C as I'm cradling that and just rolling my fingers out and back. And then as you're power cradling it, you're just getting your elbows, and now my arms and shoulders more involved, and that C is getting a lot bigger, right? So to get the concept down, first work on just letting the stick rock like this in your hand, feel the ball wanting to cradle itself, and then you start rolling your fingers and you're making a small C at the end of the head, right? So there's a small C there. As you start getting your elbows again, the ball's not hitting the sidewalls, it's staying in the bottom of the pocket. As I start accentuating this C and making the C bigger, I'm getting my arms, my elbows, and my shoulders involved, right? So as I'm running full speed down the field, this is what that's looking like. And I'm trying to keep the stick as vertical as possible. If you're in congestion, you have defenders on, you got pressure, then you want to keep that stick tight against your body and you want to keep it vertical. I'm not dropping it, leaving it out here for a trail check, or I'm protecting the bottom of the stick, the top of the stick. I'm keeping it vertical against my body. And that's how you cradle, okay? So start here, bottom hand is a guide, make that small C, then grow that C, make that C bigger, and then make the stick vertical. That's a cradle. And if you do it one-handed, this is what it looks like, okay? Now, one thing that we're gonna be working on is transitioning from a right-handed to a left-handed cradle, right? When you're doing that, because you just caught the ball and you gotta switch over, it's one fluid single motion. It's not one, two, over. It's not like two or three motion. It's a single fluid switch, right? And here's how we do that. So once you got the cradling down, then you can work on going from one hand to the other, right? So let's work on our two-handed cradle. We're cradling it like this. When we transition it over, it's kind of like taking a sword and dropping it into the sheath, right? That's step one. You drop it down, you bring this hand up, and then you put the bottom hand on the bottom as a guide, right? Now we're back in the same position. So we drop the sword in the sheath, step one. As we're doing that, we're bringing our top hand up, bringing the left hand, which was the top hand before, down to the bottom as the guide, and then we're cradling it. So it'll look like that, just one fluid motion, dropping it into the sheath, bringing the hand up at the same time, and then we're right back in cradling position, right? So it's almost like you're throwing the stick over. So as I'm making the top of that C, I can throw the stick over, and see, I keep that centrifugal force on that ball at the back of the pocket. So you can literally stand in your driveway or put a tennis ball in your pocket if your parents let you do it in the house. And by the way, the lighter the ball you're using, the better you're going to develop the skill, because the lighter balls come out a lot easier, right? So if you have a speed lacrosse ball or a spongy ball or a tennis ball, even a racquetball, throw something light in there and then just practice this. You'll see my weight shift from my right foot to my left foot. If you were defending me, here's what it would look like. I'm keeping the stick tight to my body. I'm keeping the stick vertical. And it's one fluid motion. So that's something we want to work on. Again, just in summary, bottom hand is a guide. We're dropping the stick into the sheath. At the same time, bringing that bottom hand up and then returning the other hand to the bottom as a guide. That's all we're doing. Sheath, bring it up. Sheath, bring it up. We're shifting our body weight as we do that to the opposite foot. And that's how we cradle and protect the stick, right? So now here's a drill where we're putting together that transition from right to left. We're throwing and catching at the same time. And then we're also cradling in between each pass, okay? So we're gonna put that all together right now with Justin, and I'll walk you through it. So he's gonna catch it with his right hand. And by the way, if you're a new player, it's very good to get in the habit of working on your offhand now. Because if you develop on your strong hand, which is our natural tendency, then over time, it's gonna be even tougher to wanna work on our offhand. So Justin's pretty ambidextrous. He can shoot right and left-handed, and he can play both right and left-handed. So it's a lot more diverse and more of a threat on the field. So you can see he's giving him Alex a target when he's catching the ball, transitioning it over to his other hand, He drops that, after he catches it, he drops it into the sheath with his opposite hand, and then cradles it all the way back again, right? The whole time he's keeping that ball seated in the pocket of his stick. In lacrosse, you'll notice he's got his guard up with his opposite hand to protect his stick. And in lacrosse, you can't move that hand. You gotta keep it stiff. So whether you're keeping the hand up like this, or you're keeping it down like Justin is, you just can't move it around, or else that's a ward, and then you lose possession of the ball. And that's how, if I put pressure on Justin, you're gonna see why the mechanics of this are important. If I'm defending him, he's protecting that stick and keeping his body between the stick and me. And that's pretty much how it goes, if he would have gotten a good pass from Alex. Okay guys, if you want to be a monster contributor and one of your coach's favorite players, you do like Alex here. He's a vacuum, a human vacuum. You pick up ground balls, okay? Ground balls mean possession for your team. It means more shots on goals, more offensive opportunities, and you're also taking away offensive opportunities from the opponent, right? So with the ground ball, by the way, if you're new and throwing and catching isn't your thing right now, or it's developing for you, but you get this down and you're able to give your team more possessions just by virtue of being scrappy, fearless, and going after ground balls and coming up with them, then you're gonna get some playing time, okay? Just by virtue of this skill alone. So I can't emphasize the importance of ground balls. So when you're doing a ground ball, there's a couple things that, this is probably one of the number one things that it looks so natural and easy to do, but it's the first thing that new players get wrong, okay? So if you follow these three tips, then you're never gonna miss a ground ball, okay? Number one is, generally speaking, you don't wanna get anxious when you're picking up a ground ball. Because if you get anxious coming after a ground ball and we're both fighting for the ball, you hear his footsteps coming and you know it's gonna get physical, then you're gonna come over the ball, you're gonna come back. You wanna get gritty, scrappy, and dominate this ground ball, okay? First of all, the mechanics of the ground ball, and then we're gonna talk about how you get in the way of someone else that's trying to pick up the same ground ball. First thing is, you wanna be over the ball and you want a low center of gravity, okay? So when you're gonna pick up the ground ball, you're not, here's what new players tend to do. You try to come lean over and pick up the ball and your feet are back here and then you're out of balance. Anytime your nose gets beyond your toes, you're out of balance, and that could be defending somebody, or it could be picking up a ground ball, right? Generally speaking, you wanna stay balanced, okay? So John Wood, the famous basketball coach, says the game's all about balance and spacing, and when it comes to balance, a lot of that is personal balance, keeping your feet and your hips underneath your head. So when you're picking up a ground ball, it's no different, right? You keep your nose over the ball, you keep your center of gravity low, and your feet under you by putting that front foot right next to the ball. If that front foot's right next to the ball, it forces your nose to be over the ball and you're still in balance and your feet are underneath you. So when you come down on it, tip number two is, pretend that there's a string from your face mask to the head of your stick and you can't break that string, and it's only about 12 to 18 inches long, okay? So that forces you to get down low on the stick. If you're not low and you're bringing your stick down but you're not following it, then you're not gonna have control of the ball. And you're also probably gonna shovel the ground, the back end of your stick's not gonna be low, right? So get your face mask close to the head of your stick, get down on that ball, it's gonna force your backhand, which is tip number three, to be low to the ground. You want the stick parallel to the ground when you pick up the ball. You don't want it up like this, or else you're gonna shovel the ground. Especially when you have pressure and you're at game speed, it's very easy to keep shoveling the ground or you come over the ball, right? So number one, front foot right next to the ball. Number two, I'm staying close ahead of my stick and coming down with it. Number three, the butt end of my stick is low and I'm trying to keep it parallel to the ground as much as possible, as opposed to up like this. So I'm coming down like this, I'm coming through the ball. I'm not breaking that string as I'm coming up, because if I come up and my stick's low and then I try to bring that stick up, number one, I'm leaving the stick out to be checked. But then also when I bring it up, a lot of times you'll see people fling the ball out from congestion like that because they're not coming up with the ball, right? So again, step one, lead foot next to the ball, keeps you over the ball. Step two, keep my face close to the head of the stick. Come down. Step three, I'm bringing the butt end of the stick down and I'm coming through the ball and keeping it close to my face mask. I'm bringing it to my shoulder. I'm looking upfield and sending this ball to freedom and getting it out of congestion as quick as possible. So Alex is going to demonstrate. There we go, just like that. We'll come back the other way. Okay guys, one tip forgot to mention real fast is when you're doing your ground balls, you're picking up ground balls, we call it one-time ground balls. You're just coming through the ball. That's one motion right there. We're not doing a two-motion rake, okay? So this is a very bad habit, and the reason why it's illegal in speed lacrosse is you don't want to two-step it. If you're pursuing that ground ball, you're not two-stepping it by raking it back, getting it into your stick. You're just coming through it one time. So really important, don't get into the habit of raking that ball. One-time ground ball is just come right through it. All right, now we're gonna put this together with some pressure. So we're gonna simulate two opposing players going after the same ground ball, and we're gonna show you what it looks like to box somebody out for a ground ball. So it's the same mechanics, except now, if Alex and I are not opposing teams and we're both going after this ground ball, what he wants to do is box me out by putting his body, and he's getting low, he's putting his body in between me and that ball, and then he's coming up with it the same exact way. He's looking upfield, and then he's sending it out. So when you're going after ground balls, we're not gonna talk about communication right now, but it's ultra important that, especially if you have someone else on your team going after the same ground ball, it's a two versus one situation, because then let's say I'm on the opposite team, Alex and another player on his team are going after the same ground ball. One of them is going to block me out, and then the other person is going to go after the ball. So it's the man ball command, right? In this particular case, if it's just one on one, we're going after the same ground ball. Again, same mechanics, Alex is boxing me out, he's staying low, he's picking it up, and then he's gonna send it out as quick as possible. So remember that if your team is technically, skill-wise, not as mature as the team you're playing, a lot of your goals are not gonna be in settled situations where you have a 6 versus 7 settled offense situation. A lot of those goals are going to come from being in unsettled situation where there's an offensive ground ball, their whole defense is not set. We're fighting for this ground ball. It's on his offensive side of the field. They pick up the ground ball. He sends it to the opposite side of the field and you got an open guy typically. So it's really important that when you're picking up a ground ball, you get it moved out and into freedom as quick as possible. Okay, and then transition, same thing. If the ball's on the defensive side of the field and we're picking that ball and causing a turnover, we're sending it upfield as quick as possible because that ball moves a lot faster in the air than our feet do. So don't try to carry the ball out of congestion. Find someone open upfield and then send it. Okay guys, let's talk about shooting. This is the fun stuff, right? Now, shooting when you're starting out in this game is not about power as much as it is about placement, right? What you're doing off ball to get open is frankly more important than being able to shoot a 90 plus mile an hour shot. So considering that, keep that in mind as you're playing. But to go over the shooting mechanics very quickly, you just want to remember three things, okay? So a shot is basically three different movements that we're going to put into one, and Justin's going to demonstrate. Justin, by the way, has a 90, last time we clocked it, 94 mile an hour shot. Might be a little bit faster. 95 mile an hour shot coming out of high school, okay? And this kid picked up a stick as a freshman? Yeah, as a freshman. So, difference between growth mindset and fixed mindset. Google that. If you have a growth mindset, you're gonna come back every single season so much better, exponentially better every season. So, anyway, the shot mechanics. There's three movements that you're putting all together into one, okay? First of all, with the shot, your power, just like punching and other mechanics and other sports, power comes from your feet, all right? But so when you're shooting, and also your momentum, when you're talking about a time and space shot or a step down shot, because you're coming from up top and you have room, and then you're getting the momentum of a run behind you, and then you're shooting. That's if you're ripping it and you're going for power, right? But I'm just talking the general basics of a shot, okay? So when you're doing a shot, you're putting three things together. First thing is your weight's on your back foot, and the weight's on the balls of your feet. Your foot's still on the ground, but the weight's on the ball of your feet. Your stick is back, you want extension generally, and the motion is gonna look like this. So your stick is back, the head is higher than your hands. Your hands are up high and back, so you get extension. And then when you're gonna shift forward, number two, get that bottom hand out in front of you. You don't wanna shoot from back here and come over without keeping that extension by putting that hand out in front of you, okay? So you want that bottom hand out in front, and then you wanna come over that hand as your weight shifts from the back foot to the front foot. So step one is your weight's on the back foot, your hands are up high, your arm should be at about a 90 degree angle right here, and then you wanna be kissing your shoulder. If the bottom of your face mask is on your shoulder, then you know you got that extension, right? Be careful not to drop the head of your stick low. A lot of new players will do that and they'll lose the ball a lot of times. Keep the head of your stick higher than your hands, but your hands are up high about eye level and they're back and the weight's on your back foot. That's position number one. Position number two is you're bringing everything forward as you're shifting your weight from your back foot to your front foot. So that bottom hand get that hand out in front of you a little bit, and that's number two. Okay, so you're almost like taking the bottom of that stick and you're gonna hammer or thump somebody in the forehead with it almost. That's going towards your target, okay? So get that bottom hand out in front of you too, and we're exaggerating that for the sake of this movement, okay? When you put it all together, you'll see how we're not gonna go out that far. But one, two, weight shifts to the front, bottom hand comes out in front of you, your head of your stick is still higher than your hands, and then three is going to be bringing this front elbow, you're torquing your whole body and you're bringing this front elbow to the sky, okay? And pulling the bottom and breaking your wrists and bringing this top hand over. But the follow through has got to be there. Be sure this front elbow goes to the sky as you're coming over. So it's going to look like that. Elbows up towards the sky, your front elbow, the head of the stick is down, you come all the way through it, and you want to go from, we call it about the 11 o'clock position. You want to be overhand when you're first starting to shoot. A lot of new players and players that haven't grown much because they just do what's comfortable are still shooting sidearm, and it's not going to be as good for your placement. As you grow as a player, you can start shooting sidearm for power or going 45 degrees with it. But in the beginning, work on getting your head out of the way and then coming overhand from 11 o'clock down to about 6 or 5 o'clock, okay? That's kind of the motion or the range that you wanna shoot. So again, here's what it looks like from the front. You got your hands up high, your weight's on your back foot, the head of your stick's higher than your hands, you got extension, you're kissing your shoulder. That's one. Two, weight's going to the front foot, I'm punching my stick out. And then three, I'm driving this elbow through to the sky, and then I'm coming over. And that's a shot. So we're gonna see Justin put it all together from a catch, from a feed, into his shot. As you're drilling, you wanna work on placement more than you wanna work on power initially. So as Justin is finding a spot on goal, don't just arbitrarily shoot into the net. He's aiming for that top right corner. He's placing that ball. And when you're drilling and shooting on goal, you want to start closer to the goal. Take those shots, get that placement down, find out where your wrist has to break. If you're going high, you got to break your wrist a little bit later. You know, that means you're breaking your wrist too early. If you're going too low, you're waiting too long to break that wrist and bring that stick around. So once you find your placement, you can start moving back and then get a little bit more speed on your shot and more torque. So you notice his hands are gonna be up high when he shoots. Now he's coming down more sidearm. He gets his bottom hand out in front of him before he comes over. And it's almost like a rubber band snap when you can get your bottom hand out and then you come over it. All of his power is coming from his base, his feet, and then that torque through his midsection. And you'll notice that front elbow, his left elbow, is coming all the way through to finish the rotation. And that's your shot. Okay guys, we're going over defensive basics right now on individual one-on-one defense, okay? So there are a lot more complexities when it comes to team defense and what you're supposed to be doing as a defender as that ball moves around. But when you're one-on-one with the ball carrier, your number one goal here is to get them to pass that ball off or cause a turnover. If you've done either of those things, you've done your job as a defender, okay? So you have two things that you're working on defense is your approach and your recovery, okay? And it becomes especially important when you are man down on defense and they have one extra player. Approach and recovery is critical. Your approach to break down in front of the ball carrier, and then when they pass that ball off, your recovery coming back. And your recovery, frankly, getting back is more important when you're man down than your approach is, okay? So you gotta get back quick. So some fundamentals on defense. Our body, we're keeping a good low base. The lower man on defense usually wins, okay? So when I'm breaking down on my opponent here, on my approach, I'm coming up, I'm chopping my steps. In other words, I'm not taking big strides at him because if he cuts and dodges, I can't react full stride and he's just gonna beat me. So on your approach, you wanna come in, chop up your steps, and get low. So the top of my face mask is gonna be right around where his neck is if we're the same height. This is where I wanna be. I wanna be generally lower him. I want my feet shoulder width apart. Weight's on the balls of my feet, I'm ready to react, and my stick is in his face, okay? If he's coming this way, until I don't ideally wanna have to turn my hips. He's watching me turn my hips. As soon as I turn my hips and he cuts, reverses his direction, then it's gonna be hard for me to react and keep up. So I wanna side shuffle as much as I can. So in slow motion, I'm side shuffling, I'm checking, I'm working his bottom hand here. And until he's going fast to me, I don't wanna ideally have to turn my hips. He's trying to get me to turn my hips, go that direction for him to reverse or beat me. So again, on my approach, I'm coming up, getting lower than him. I'm chopping up my steps in his face. I'm working his bottom hand, either through a lift or a poke check. Anytime, guys, you're coming over like an axe, you're not hacking, it's a risky check when you're coming over like this, because if you hit plastic, you're gonna see a flag in most cases. So when on my approach, I'm getting my stick in his face, and the two best checks to work as a new player is poke checks. I'm going like this, just working his bottom hand. I'm trying to interfere or interrupt his passing or his cradling to cause a turnover, or I'm doing a lift and I'm just focusing on that bottom hand. If that's all you remember as a new player, you're gonna be deadly. And then the other thing is, I'm not just going after the stick the whole time. If I'm playing good positioning, I'm putting my hands down on the stick. Here's where it gets physical. I'm getting lower than him. I'm putting my hands on his hips, not up top, because he can inside roll or roll off of me pretty easily up top. And then it beat me on balance. I want to get my hands down low on his hips and I'm driving his hips out, but my hands are together. I'm not cross-checking him and keeping my hands apart, right? So again, fundamentals on defense, my approach, chopping it down, getting low, working that bottom hand, lifting, I'm driving his hips out. I'm not leaning over my feet because then he can beat me. I'm keeping my feet under me as much as possible, and I'm not trying to turn my hips until he forces me to with his speed. Okay, so when he passes that ball, if I'm doing my job right, he doesn't have an option here, he wants to pass it out. I'm coming back on my recovery, putting my stick up to cover the passing lanes, and I'm recovering back here and keeping my stick up on the passing lane. I'm watching the ball over here, they call it C3. C3 means I see the ball, I see my man at the same time, and I'm seeing the middle in between, So I'm looking at the grass right here, but I'm kind of watching the ball in the peripheral of my vision, listening to the goalie on where the ball is, and I'm not taking my eyes off my guy. As soon as I turn my head to watch that ball go, he's gonna cut behind me and get open. So again, C3 is that triangle vision where I'm watching where the ball is now, keeping my eyes on my guy, and I'm watching the ground right there. Okay guys, so Alex is gonna put this all together now, right? You're gonna see him on his approach, you're gonna see him on his recovery. When the ball carrier passes the ball off, I'll be behind the camera playing as one of Justin's teammates. And then you'll see Alex recover, approach, recover, approach, recover, okay? And you'll see how this pressure looks with Justin moving the ball around a little bit. He's on his body, working that bottom hand, his stick's up, he's covering the passing lanes. As you notice, Alex is watching his player on the outside because Justin's looking for the opportunity to cut behind him. Approach, working the body, he's keeping his center of gravity, his feet and his hips underneath him, and he's staying low. Now he's watching both of us. He's not letting his guy run behind him. Approach, he's recovering. Approach, working his hips. Controlled checks, working that bottom hand, trying to get that turnover, driving his body out. And that's how you play defense in lacrosse. Okay guys, so to be a threat on offense and to get even more shots open, you gotta learn how to beat your defender one-on-one, to force a slide, to create an opening on offense and to disrupt the defense, okay? So we call that initiating on offense. If you can dodge and force that slide and disrupt the defense and cause them to shift, then you're gonna create openings for the offense and you're gonna start off with the ball on settled offensive plays. So we're gonna pretend here that we've got Justin trying to beat Alex on a one-on-one situation, okay? We're gonna do two basic dodges. There are a lot of dodges out there, but we're gonna work on two. One is a simple one called a face dodge, where if you're not good at work at cradling with your offhand, we're gonna keep the stick in the same hand. It's a face dodge. You're coming across your face and you're beating your guy like this and then returning the stick so you're not switching hands, okay? The other dodge is pretty common is a split dodge, and that's where you're coming up on your defender. You're planting on one side, you're selling one direction, coming back the other direction, and then you're switching over, just like we were talking on that transition over to your other hand, okay? Protecting the stick, keeping it close to your body, and not leaving anything out for a check, and then you're running past your guys. So the first dodge we're gonna look at Justin demonstrating is a face dodge. Just coming up, plant, sell one side, come across. It's almost like a basketball crossover. Plant, bring it across your face, keep it tight to your body, run past your guy, then return the stick to your shoulder without leaving it all the way out here. And then you can either pass the ball or you can shoot. Here's what it looks like from the side. All right, let's see that one more time. And then we'll do it from the other direction. So he's coming across his body, keeping that head of the stick by his ear. Let's come across from the right side now. Keeping that stick across his face tight towards his ear, and then returning it back to his shoulder when he passes. There you go. One more time. All right, that's a face dodge. A split dodge is the same thing, except you're transitioning that stick from one hand to the other hand. This is just like the crossover. Plant, cross it over, protect the stick, and then send it, or shoot. Let's see it from the other direction. Now let's go left to right from that side. You've been marveling at Alex's long hair. We call that flow in lacrosse. It makes you better. And that's our split dodge. Okay guys, so those are our lacrosse fundamentals on passing, catching, shooting, defensive basics, ground balls, and dodging and cradling, ball control, protecting your stick. If you just practice those fundamentals, by the way, if you YouTube any of those topics, you're gonna find a lot of instructional videos. Watch those as well, but work on those individual skills in between your practices and then come out to be able to contribute with your team. I wanna thank Justin and Alex here. We'll see you in other videos in the future. See you on the field.
Lacrosse gets you girls, by the way.
Oh, yeah.